Hello everyone. So far we are discussing about the nucleus of hydrogen atom and the magnetic moments of protons, neutrons and everything. We forgot to discuss about the behavior of electron also. Atom is composed of protons, neutrons and electrons. We considered only the nucleus in our previous video lectures. Let us now take the consideration of that electron. What is the effect of electron and different things will be discussed in this lecture. Let us take the example of hydrogen atom. Hydrogen atom is having a proton in its nucleus and there are no neutrons. There is an orbit around this one. In this orbit there is an electron. This electron is having negative charge and it is revolving round the nucleus. In NMR spectrometer, what we discussed, this is subjected to an external magnetic field. This is the external magnetic field we applied B naught. We discussed about the behavior of this proton, but we did not discuss anything about this electron. This electron is having a negative charge and it is revolving round the nucleus. Whenever any charge revolving round the nucleus is subjected to an external magnetic field, it will create a magnetic field in opposite direction to the applied magnetic field. Who said this? In 1834, Lenz, that scientist, told that whenever a charged particle rotates in a circular orbit or in any loop and when it is subjected to an external magnetic field, it will create a local magnetic field in a direction in which it opposes the applied magnetic field. That means this electron will create a magnetic field like this, in opposite direction. However, the magnitude of this magnetic field is very, very less. Very, very less. But it is there. Okay? This type of magnetic behavior is called as local diamagnetic shield, or simply it is also called as diamagnetic anisotropy, diamagnetic anisotropy. We wrote a formula in our previous video lecture like this. Delta E is equal to gamma B naught H by 2 pi. So delta E is equal to H nu according to Planck. So the H nu is equal to gamma B naught H by 2 pi. Both H's will cancel each other. You will get this nu is equal to gamma B naught by 2 pi. Let us concentrate on this term B naught. What is this B naught? B naught is nothing but the applied external magnetic field. What we generally assume that this proton will experience the same magnitude what we applied here. Suppose if you have applied a B naught, let us take it in type of numbers to understand it very easily. I applied 100. 100 is just an arbitrary number, that's all. Just in order to explain it very clearly, I took this number 100. I applied a B naught value of 100 and I assumed that this nucleus will experience the same 100. But it will not happen like that. Here is an electron revolving round the nucleus. It will create a magnetic field in opposite direction to the applied magnetic field. So this nucleus will experience somewhat little less magnetic field than the applied real magnetic field. Suppose if you have applied 100, it will experience 99.9. A small quantity will be decreased. Why? Because it is due to the shielding of this electron. Is that clear? So this equation is to be corrected little bit. Then it was corrected like this. Nu is equal to gamma into B naught into 1 minus sigma by 2 pi. What is this sigma? This sigma is the shielding constant. That means the shielding given by the electron. So this sigma is field independent shielding constant. Suppose if there are more number of electrons around this nucleus, because this hydrogen atom is going to participate in a chemical reaction with some carbon atom like that, so there will be an array of different type of electrons. If it has more number of electrons like this, it is more shielded. If the density of these electrons is little bit less, it will be less shielded. So in NMR spectroscopy, the presence of electrons also influence the signal. Is that clear? Now let us start the schematic representation of this NMR spectrometer. Okay? Yes, let me explain the instrumentation of NMR spectrometer. What will they do? First, they will take a beaker like this one. In this beaker, they will take the sample. Let us assume that the sample is CH3, CH2, OH, that is ethyl alcohol. A small quantity of ethyl alcohol will be taken in this beaker. To this, they will add a solvent. Here, the solvent is deuterated chloroform, that is CdCl3. To this, they will add one reference compound, that is TMS, tetramethyl silane. So I will later explain why do they added this CdCl3 and TMS and other things. Let us now consider they have taken three components in this one. The component whose NMR signal is to be analyzed, that is ethyl alcohol. And the second one is deuterated chloroform. And third one is a reference compound, that is TMS compound. From this mixture of solution, they will pipette out small quantity of the solution into on a glass tube. So let us consider this be that glass tube. Okay, in this glass tube they have taken that solution. This glass tube is coiled by a coil. And it is connected to a receiver. Here is the magnetic power supply. Which is given to two magnets. This is north and south. The magnetic power supply is under control of magnetic field sweep. This is magnetic field sweep. That means by controlling a meter here, you can control the magnetic power supply. That means you can change the field of magnetic supply. The B naught value will be adjusted. So here is a coil. Which is able to generate RF signal, that radio frequency signal. This radio frequency signal comes from this transmitter. Okay. These signals will come to this recorder. Let me explain everything clearly again. The transmitter is able to generate an RF signal. It will give an RF signal in this direction, that radio frequency signal. The glass tube is placed in its position and it is coiled. The coiled wire is connected to a receiver. Okay. We can subject the magnetic field in this direction by using magnetic power supply. The field intensity will be controlled by this magnetic field sweep. It is a great scientific arrangement. If you observe clearly, the fields are perpendicular to each other. What I mean to say here is, you see, this is North Pole and this is South Pole. Let me take a big diagram of this test tube. Let this tube be this one. It is having molecules. Now, on this solution, we are applying a magnetic field in this direction. North to south. We are applying this RF signal in this direction, from back side to front direction. We are coiled. We coiled in this direction. So all were perpendicular to each other. Whenever you supply magnetic field, then protons present in this one, that means protons present in this ethyl alcohol molecule, will give NMR signals. We discussed the total theory in our previous video lecture. For clarification, please see that video. So you will get NMR signals. Those NMR signals will be given to this receiver. That means the change in magnetic flux and radio frequency, everything will be given by this coil to this receiver. This receiver will give that signal to the recorder, where this recorder will get how much magnetic field was given to the sample and what is the signal. Let this be on y-axis and this be on x-axis. Is that clear? Right. Now, I have a small doubt. What is this one? Is a coil. Upon this coil, continuously you are giving an RF signal. Whenever you give this RF signal, it is nothing but an electromagnetic radiation. It will also able to create some EMF in this coil, isn't it? Because you are giving an electromagnetic radiation upon a coil. So before this signal enters this solution, it must first touch this coil. That means the signal must touch this coil, then only it will enter the glass tube. Okay, whenever you give this signal like this, that means you are giving RF signal in this way, then here is a coil. This coil will receive that signal and that signal will also be transmitted to the receiver. Then how receiver will differentiate between two? What I mean to do is, that means here is a test tube. In this test tube also there are some excitations. It is also giving an RF signal. In this longitudinal magnetic direction and transverse magnetic direction, what we discussed in previous video lecture, no? It is also giving some excitations. The magnetic flux is continuously changing. It is also giving some signals, whereas this transmitter is also giving signals. How does this receiver differentiate between the two? So, here is the concept. That means, that's why I said this is a scientific arrangement. Let us assume that this is the glass tube. This glass tube is surrounded by a coil. Yes, it is surrounded by a coil. This glass tube has an arrangement to continuously rotate in the spectrometer. That means it is under continuous rotation in the spectrometer. Why? Because all molecules will experience the same type of magnetic field. So all molecules present in the solution will experience uniform magnetic field. For that purpose, they will put a small motor here and they will always make this glass tube to rotate. So now, let me explain clearly. So this is the glass tube. It is having a coil. Now, I am giving a radio frequency in this direction. From this one, I am giving radio frequency in this direction. So this radio frequency will first touch this coil and then only it will enter this solution. So this coil first experiences one radio frequency from the transmitter coil. That means from transmitter it will experience radio frequency. That signal will be given to the receiver. Then we applied a magnetic field. That means here is north and here is south. We applied a magnetic field in this direction. So this is north and this is south. You see here, whenever you apply the magnetic field in this direction, the molecules present in the solution will be aligned in this direction. That means molecules present in the solution will be aligned in this direction. Or opposite to this direction. So you please see, suppose if it is the molecular arrangement, so it is perpendicular That means this molecular arrangement is perpendicular to this one. It is in this direction. This RF signal is in this direction. Whenever there are excitations, what will happen? Two components. One is longitudinal, another one is transverse. In the previous video, we already discussed, no? So, in this direction or in this direction, it will generate RF signal or change in magnetic flux. So, this RF signal is also taken by this coil and will be given to that receiver. Now, this receiver is able to differentiate the two signals. That means one signal coming from this one and one signal coming from this one, both are having a difference of 90 degrees phase. So, they have a 90 degree phase difference. So, easily that receiver differentiates both the signals and will give the signal given by the solution to this recorder, and this recorder will take the corresponding magnetic field. So, in order to make the molecules coming to resonance, we have two possibilities. One is you can fix this RF signal and can change the magnetic field by using emitter magnetic field sweep here. Or you can fix the magnetic field, you can change the transmitter signal. Whatever may be the condition, you will get resonance. That means the precision nuclei are having one frequency, you have to give the same frequency. Okay, so in order to give the same frequency, either you can change the frequency or you can put constant frequency and change the magnetic field to gain that level. That means molecules, if you change the magnetic field, they will gain that level by taking a greater delta and will come to this frequency level. On either cases, you will get resonance. From this resonance only, change in magnetic flux will occur. A complete discussion about the theory part was already given in the previous video lecture. So, this is the schematic representation of NMR spectrometer. Now, I want to explain why did you add that deuterated chloroform. Okay. In the experiment, we have taken a beaker. In that beaker, we took the sample C2H5OH. To it, you added a solvent CdCl3. In this CdCl3, we took D in place of H. Generally, we knew chloroform CHCl3. We took CdCl3. Why? Because this D is having a value of spin quantum number I is equal to 1. Did you remember in the second video lecture of NMR spectroscopy, we saw that I is equal to 1 for deuterium. So, its spin states are different from the spin states of hydrogen of this ethyl alcohol. This H is having a spin quantum number of I is equal to plus half. So, both will respond in NMR spectra, but its spectrum can be easily differentiated. Why? Because its spin value is something different from the spin value of this proton. So, we can just take the resonance of this one. Of course, if you have taken this resonance also, you can get the spectra of this deuterium at some place, and you can get the spectra of these protons at some other place. So, easily we can differentiate the two spectra. And again, we added a reference. That is TMS. In order to explain this concept, again, we must see the electronic arrangement of this ethyl alcohol. Let us write the molecular structure of ethyl alcohol molecule. This is C, H, H, H. C H O H. Yeah, what is the arrangement of these bonded electrons? It is having 2 electrons. It is also having 2 electrons. Did you all remember the concept of electronegativity? Did you all remember the concept of electronegativity? What is meant by electronegativity? Electronegativity is the tendency of an atom to attract a shared pair of electrons towards itself. So, you see here, this carbon is having 6 protons in its nucleus. So, it is capable of attracting these 2 electrons towards itself. So, what can it do? It is also an electron pair. What will it do? It will little bit attract these 2 electrons towards itself. These 2 electrons like this. These 2 electrons like this. So, they are not really present at the center as shown in this diagram. They will little bit move towards this carbon. So, these 2 will come to this place. Similarly, these 2 will come to this place. That means they are closer to carbon. Again, these 2 will come to this place. They won't come too much close. Why? Because these 2 are carbon atoms. These 2 carbon atoms are having a pair of electrons. They are situated exactly at the center because there is no electronegativity difference between the 2. So, these 2 electron pairs will repel this one. So, wherever the repulsions are little bit satisfied, less repulsions are present there, that type of molecular arrangement or electronic arrangement will happen around this carbon atom. Now, we are not considering this carbon because carbon is C12 isotope. It will not give any signal in NMR spectroscopy, etc., etc. We discussed. So, what I mean to say here is this hydrogen atom is somewhat free from this electron. Whenever the electron pair is nearer to hydrogen atom, it will shield that nucleus. That means suppose these 2 electrons are nearer to this place. That means if these 2 electrons are here at the center, they will shield the nucleus. If they are little bit far away from that place, this type of shielding little bit decreases. Whenever the shielding little bit decreases, the nucleus of this hydrogen will experience more B naught. Is that clear? Let me explain here. Here is oxygen. Oxygen is more electronegative than carbon. So, it will attract this pair very nearer to this one. Now, this proton is very free from the shielding of electrons. So, it can experience more magnetic field. So, what happens here? These 2 are not carbons. It is carbon and this one is oxygen. So, automatically the electron pair will come more nearer to this oxygen atom. Now, this carbon atom will attract this shared pair of electrons towards itself with greater force than this one. Why? Because the electron pair present between these 2 oxygen atoms is not at the center position as in case of this one. So, they will get a little bit attracted towards that side. Similarly, these 2 also will come nearer to carbon atom. So, now we have 3 different type of protons. this is one type. These two protons are other type. Let me number this one as second type. These three protons are different. That means these are all third type. How I am able to write these types? Depending upon the concept of that shielding effect. So this proton will precess with one type of frequency. These two protons will precess with a different type of frequency, and these three will precess in different frequency. That means the frequencies of these three protons are different. Let us check once whether in all these things which will have more precision. Yeah, you are right, it is having more precision. Why? Because the electrons are not shielding this one, so it is always subjected to external magnetic field. It will have a large delta E value. If delta E value is high, then automatically nu is also high, no? So it has a great frequency. And the next is this one. It is having a frequency little less than that one. It is having a frequency little more less than this one. So the resonance frequency is also different. So whenever you give an electromagnetic radiation, you have to give very very energetic wave to this one to make it into a resonance. That means it is pressing with more frequency, so you have to give energetic RF signal. For this little bit less, for this little bit more less, so you will get three types of signals like this in NMR spectra for this ethyl alcohol molecule. Why we started this discussion? In order to explain the concept of TMS. Yes, this is the structure of tetramethylsilane. Here a silicon atom is present. This silicon is not an electronegative atom. That means it does not attract the shared pair of electrons towards itself much. That means the electrons present between this carbon and silicon will be at the center position, almost at the center position. So all will be almost at their center positions. That means electron pair is equidistant from the two, nearly equidistant. So this carbon is not able to attract the shared pair of electrons of this CH bond towards itself with more power, because some electronic charge is there. So it is somewhat satisfied with that charge. So this electron pair is also little bit at the center. Of course, it is a little bit nearer to carbon, but not much. So like that, how many protons are there? Just count them. Yes, we are having 12 protons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. So we are having 12 protons. All 12 protons have same type of electronic arrangement. All electrons are shielding hydrogen atoms with more power because there are little bit nearer to hydrogen atom when compared with the other organic compounds. So these are more shielded. you have to apply more magnetic field in order to go into the nucleus of these hydrogens to get a resonance signal. So this compound, this tetramethylsilane compound, is taken as a reference compound from which all other signals are measured. Now I want to explain what is meant by this chemical shift. I want to explain this chemical shift concept by taking a simple example, that is an experiment from physics. You might have seen this type of simple pendulum experiment. It contains a bob. This bob is attached by a string to this stand. They will perform this simple pendulum experiment in order to find the acceleration due to gravity or to calculate the frequency of the oscillating pendulum. So they will take this bob to some position. That angle must be less than 5 degrees. Now this bob is here. They will just release this bob. It starts oscillations. So it will oscillate like this. It will come to one position and finally it reaches a maximum height, then again comes here. This type of oscillations it will give. While it is oscillating, they will take the number of oscillations per second. That means they will first take one stopwatch like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. There are some numbers. There will be one needle, there will be one pin. Whenever the bob comes to the maximum height, whenever the velocity becomes zero, they will just start the experiment by clicking this pin. Then they will take the tabulation like this. When time t is equal to 0, number of oscillations is equal to 0. After 5 seconds, that means when time t is equal to 5 seconds, number of oscillations let be 7. After t is equal to 10 seconds, number of oscillations will be 12. Like that, they will take a note of it. Now, I want to ask you a simple question. Will time be zero at any moment? No, it will not happen. Time always continues to go on. Let this experiment be started at early in the morning, 6 o'clock, 5 minutes. 00 seconds. Then after 5 seconds means 6 o'clock, 5 minutes, 05 seconds. 6 o'clock, 5 minutes, 10 seconds. Like that, the time will go. But they took the time as 0 for the calculation purpose. That means to make the calculation easy. They took like this. That means the difference between two is 5 seconds. The difference between two is 5 seconds. Here also, difference between these two is 5 seconds. Difference between these two is 5 seconds. It is highly typical for any person to calculate from this calculation. It is very easy for us to calculate from this type of calculation. In both calculations, you will find the same answer. Is that clear? So they took time t is equal to 0. This 0 is an arbitrary 0. They assumed the time that it be 0. In the similar manner, in chemical shift also, you are going to add a reference compound which we have already discussed. This is, let it be C2H5OH ethyl alcohol. This is CdCl3 deuterated chloroform. And now they added another compound, that is tetramethyl silane. We already discussed about it. This tetramethyl silane contains protons which are more shielded by electrons. They took this sample. Whenever this solution is subjected to external magnetic field, protons will give resonance. Protons present in TS, TMS will give resonance, and these protons will also give resonance. The resonance frequency for these protons is very, very low. Nu is very, very low for protons present in tetramethyl silane. Why? Because they are more shielded. What it means? In tetramethyl silane, there are protons. Six. Let us take six for example. Here two. Here two protons. All these protons were more and more shielded by electrons. So whenever you apply external magnetic field, this magnetic field is not experienced by all these nuclei. These nuclei will experience a lower magnetic field than the applied one because of that electronic shielding. So the energy difference delta E is very less. The delta E is very less. So automatically, since delta E is less, delta E means delta E is proportional to nu frequency. So since delta E is less, nu will also be less. The frequency is very less for tetramethyl silane protons. That frequency, that resonance frequency is taken as zero on a scale. Let this be zero. Really, it is not zero. It is having some value, but very, very low value. We consider that low value as zero just in case of this simple pendulum experiment. Any other proton you take in organic chemistry, any other proton will have high nu value when compared to this tetramethyl silane. So other peaks are observed at some places like this. Just we'll find how far this signal is away from this tetramethyl signal. How far this signal is away from this tetramethyl signal. In that manner, we'll take, here they took 5 seconds difference, 5 seconds difference, like that we'll always subtract the value of this TMS from the observed frequency. The chemical shift is denoted by the letter small delta, where this small delta is equal to nu S minus nu TMS divided by Z in megahertz. What is this nu S? Nu S is the resonance frequency of the sample. Nu TMS is the resonance frequency of the tetramethyl silane, and Z is the radio frequency in megahertz. Why did we take this parameter into this formula? Let me explain you clearly. Suppose there is a magnetic field of B naught is equal to 1.41 Tesla, and this radio frequency is 60 megahertz, and if you observe this new value at 162 hertz, take a simple calculation, what will you get? That means 162 by 60 is equal to how much we will get? nearly 2.71. Suppose I take the proton of the sample to another instrument where its B naught value is 2.53 Tesla and its RF is 100 and your observed new value is at 270. Perform the same calculation, 270 by 100, that is equal to 2.7. That means if you divide this value with the RF value, you will get the same value upon any instrument. From one NMR spectrometer to another NMR spectrometer, the B naught value changes. Whenever B naught value change, automatically delta E value, that separation will also change. Whenever delta E changes, the frequency with which this proton precesses will change. Whenever the frequency changes, you have to change the RF signal also. So like that, for every instrument you will get a different type of nu. Suppose if you divide it by the RF, then you will get the same value on any instrument. That's why I took this Z. Z is nothing but that radio frequency at which you observe the resonance. You will get a constant value for any instrument. Here these two frequencies are in hertz. It is in megahertz. Let us have a look and let us consider that the difference between these two gave a value x in hertz. Then this Z into 10 power 6 into hertz, when you convert mega hertz into hertz, it will come 10 power 6. Let us take X hertz by Z hertz into 1 by 10 power 6. Hertz will cancel each other. So you will get a chemical shift value per 10 to the power of 6. 10 to the power of 6 means what? Parts per million. So the delta value is always a value, let it be value be y, that x by z is equal to y, ppm. In this way, we can take the signal in NMR spectroscopy. Is that clear? Finally, I want to give a conclusion to this video lecture. Conclusion, in this lecture we took the example of hydrogen atom. And we observed the effect of electronic rotation upon the magnetic field induced by this nucleus. That means whenever an atom is subjected to external magnetic field, we assume or we think that the same magnetic field B naught value will be experienced by the nucleus, but it will not happen in that manner. The electron revolving round the nucleus will create a magnetic field opposite to the direction of the applied magnetic field, and it renders or diminishes the applied magnetic field. So the net magnetic field observed by this nucleus is little bit less than the given magnetic field. This concept is called as diamagnetic shielding. It shields the nucleus. Whenever electrons are very nearer to the nucleus and there are more number of electrons, this type of shielding is more. If you take the example of tetramethylsilane, every proton is surrounded by two electrons very nearer to the nucleus than any other compound. So this TMS protons are in shielding, greater shielding, so they experience less magnetism. If there is any possibility like OH, that means in this one the electron pair is very nearer to oxygen when compared with the TMS proton. So this type of proton is called deshielded proton. This proton is called as deshielded proton. This proton will experience more magnetic power. That means this B naught value is more for this proton. Suppose if it is 100, you will get 99.9 for this one. Suppose if it is 100 and if this proton is TMS proton, you will get 98. Just to understand only, I am writing these values. Depending on the shielding effects, automatically the resonance frequencies will change. The change in resonance frequencies is the basic for NMR spectroscopy. The change in resonance frequencies and all other are calculated by chemical shift methods. That means chemical shift is just a scale. You will take the difference between two signals in comparison or in reference with this TMS. Did you understand it clearly? Thank you. Thank you very much for watching this video.